So hello everyone. So in this lecture we will continue the remaining part where we have left. So in the previous lecture we already have discussed I think the optimization problems, different optimization problems, okay, the different optimization formulation optimization problem, what are the different nature of the optimization problems. Okay, we have seen what is the optimality condition for the any function for the optimal for the optimum. Okay, so in this in that series, in that order, we have already calculated the Hessian matrix. Okay, we have seen the gradient, how to calculate the gradient matrix, how we have calculated the Hessian matrix. Okay, so we have also seen the meanings of eigenvalue. Okay, then we have given some assignment to you and you have already submitted this assignment. Okay, so then we have discussed the different form of the quadratic. Okay, quadratic form, and we already have seen the symmetrization of matrices, by which we have defined the different types of definiteness function. First we have defined the positive definite, then we have defined the negative definite, then we have defined the non-negative, that is the positive semi-definite, positive negative semi-definite, and indefinite function. Okay, we already seen the nature of that curve, a positive definite, negative term definite, semi-definite, and positive and negative semi-definite. So in that series we already have covered all these things. Okay, now we are going to discuss with the how we will find the definiteness of the matrix. Okay, definiteness of the matrix. So in that order, first we have defined the quadratic function, that is the x transpose p x, that dimension of this is the dimension of this is you can see here x transpose p x, that is the n cross 1. Okay, now we already have said the property of this you can say the p scalar matrix or the p matrix is should be the symmetric. Okay, so once it is a p equal to p transpose, or it is a symmetric, then positive definite function is defined as, for the function p into nn, and it means the p matrix has a dimension of n cross n, that is the square matrix, it is the positive definite when the quadratic function x transpose px is greater than 0, whenever x is not equal to 0. The condition should be provided here, p is equal to p transpose, that is the symmetric matrix, and it always greater than equal to 0. In a similar way, we can define the negative definite function, negative definite matrix, for the p, for negative definite matrix, that is the pnn. The pnn should be negative definite function, that is the p less than 0, if the x transpose px, that is the quadratic function x transpose px, is less than equal to 0, where also when again x, the condition is x not equal to 0. In similar way, we can define the positive definite function, positive semi-definite function, or that is the positive semi-definite matrix. So for the positive semi-definite matrix P, it is equal to, the condition for the positive semi-definite matrix is x transpose Px should be greater than equal to 0 when x is not equal to 0. That is the difference between the positive definite and positive semi-definite is, the x transpose px is greater than 0 in the case of positive definite, however in the semi-definite is equal to 0. Okay, it may be the equal to 0, we will see from the problem. And then the negative semi-definite, so pnn again, n cross n is negative semi-definite, that the p less than equal to 0, if x transpose px is less than or equal to 0. The condition, difference in the condition for the negative definite and the negative semi-definite is equal to 0 here. Negative semi-definite matrix include equal to 0 with the less than 0 condition. Okay, now Now, how we will check the positive definite matrix? Okay, this is the definition. However, now the question is how you test this matrix is either the positive definite, negative definite, or whatever. Okay, so in that series, we have taken the one example. We are using a one criteria, that is the Sylvester criteria or Sylvester theorem, for checking the matrix positive definite or negative definite matrix. Okay, for that purpose, we have to first convert. So Sylvester theorem is always work or applied if P is symmetrical matrix. Okay, if the P is not symmetrical matrix, now we have to change or we have to transform that P matrix into the symmetric matrix. Now question is how it is converted. So by the simple formula P plus P transpose by 2, this becomes a symmetric matrix, or it for the, you know, for the positive definite function, the definition is given x transpose px, x transpose px, x transpose px is greater than equal to 0. Symmetric matrix, so it is given by the P plus P transpose by 2. Okay, and P plus P transpose is defined as another matrix, that is, since it is now it becomes a Q matrix. So this is the P plus P transpose by 2, there's a symmetric matrix. The transform symmetric matrix is now defined as a new matrix, that is the Q. Okay, so the condition becomes x transpose Qx equal to 0, greater than 0. So now the Sylvester theorem we can now apply. Okay, so next is our theorem. So how we will apply, see from this slide. So the first criteria for the symmetric matrix, all the diagonal must be the positive, okay, and non-zero elements. However, all the leading principal minors must be positive. So for the positive definite matrix, these two conditions we follow, then you can say the matrix is the positive definite. Okay, so what is the meaning of minors? You can find out the minors with the of the determinants. How it will see with this example. So let's say we have to check the positive definite function or positive negative definite function. We have to check the definiteness function of this quadratic function. So let's say fx is given here. Fx is equal to 7x1 square plus 4x1 plus 10x1 x3 plus 5x2 plus 8x2 x3 plus 9x3 square. Okay. Now this x is the function of t3 vector, that is the x1, x2, x3, right? x1, x2, x3. Now our target is to first we have to convert this equation into the some quadratic function. So the quadratic function having three variables x1, x2, x3. Now we have defined x1, x2, x3 as x vector. Okay. Now x1, x2, x3 and this matrix. Okay. See here very carefully. Now how it is defined? Okay, see here 7, 4, 10, then the 0, 5, 8, then 0, 0, 9. In this way we have defined the matrix, but this matrix is not a symmetric matrix. So first our target is to convert this matrix into symmetric matrix, because x transpose qx should be greater than 0. Sylvester theorem is only applied whenever this matrix is the symmetric matrix. Okay. So now our target is to convert this matrix into the symmetric matrix. So how it is converted? The second column, first row, the 4 numeric has been converted into 2. You can check from this value. 4 is written here from the 2 and 2. When it is multiplied again, it is again get 4. Okay, and the 10 and plus 10 is 5, it is converted to 5. This 4 is again 4. 8, this 8 is written here in the form of 4, and this 9 is copied here. Okay, so by this way you can convert this in the symmetric matrix. I am repeating once again how it is written. So the simple technique is 7 is copied here. Okay, 4 is 2 plus 2, 4. 8 is 4 plus 4, 8, and 15 is 5 plus 5 plus 5, 15. Okay, and this 9 is this one. So from you can visualize from this matrix, you can see here the quality, the advantage of this matrix is that this matrix is symmetric, and we can represent x into q into x. Okay, so you can write here, this is the x transpose, this is the q, this is the x. So x transpose qx, this is the quadratic form of the function. Okay, now we can see from this picture the diagonal matrix, the first the diagonal element. Okay, the diagonal element of this matrix, the principal diagonal, you can say the principal diagonal element of this matrix is, you can say, the positive or non-zero, and therefore the first criteria of the Sylvester theorem is applied here. Now we have to check the leading principal minor determinants should be the positive, and how it can be checked. So you have to first principal minor, so you have to calculate the first principal minor, sorry, you have to calculate the first principal minor. How? So you have to first calculate the first order term, first order, then you have to calculate the for 2 by 2 matrix, then you have to calculate the 3 by 3 matrix. Okay, so first is the you can say, sorry, it's my mistake, what you have done I don't know. So what is the problem? Okay, now see, so in the first principal minors, the first order is 7, then we have to check for the 2 by 2 matrix, then 2 by 2 matrix becomes 7, 2, 2, 5, so 35 minus 4, you can, again it is a greater than 0, first element, first minor is again a greater than 0, now we have to check for the 3 by 3 matrix, okay. 3 by 3 matrix, you can see here, you have not calculated, but you can calculate, okay, 3 by 3, so you can, when you calculate the determinant, again, you get the 0, greater than 0, so it means P is greater than 0, that is the definite matrix function, okay, that is the positive definite matrix, okay. Now, suppose you have to check the test for the negative definite. How will you check? So again I have defined Q must be the Q transpose, that is the symmetric matrix, okay, and again you have to remind that always X transpose PX greater than 0. So X transpose PX is nothing but it is a one kind of, you can say, this is the scalar quantity, okay, this is the scalar quantity when X. So this is the positive definite function. Okay, now when you multiplied by the negative term, minus term, okay, so the all the term that is X transpose PX that was greater than 0 now becomes, due to the multiplication of negative term, it becomes less than 0, right? Now you can take P minus P as a here, you can take the minus P, you can take this scalar quantity here, minus P as a, or you can define X transpose minus P X greater than 0. Now you have defined minus P as a Q, okay, Q as equals to minus P matrix, okay. Now we have to check the, again, same criteria for the minors and you can say for the diagonal matrix, okay. So you can say from that matrix, okay, the either this is the, you can say this is the positive definite or the negative definite matrix, okay. So for the negative definite matrix, all the leading principal minors with each order are positive and non-zero. However, the all the leading principal minors with odd order, okay, should be the negative, okay. You can find from this this the previous slide, okay. You can say here, whenever you can find this is the term minus 1 to the power n determinant of A, when you're going to find the even order of the leading minors of the even order, you can say, then it should be the positive. However, because minus 1 to the power even term always give the positive terms, therefore I am saying this is the positive. And whenever you are taking the odd term, that is a minus 1 to the power something, that will give the negative terms, right? So therefore, this is the techniques to find out the definiteness of the function of the matrix. Okay, or especially for the square square matrix. For the quadratic function. Okay, quadratic function you can find like this, right? Now conclusion is, for the first order, that the negative, second order the positive, third order again negative, and so on. Fourth order the positive, fifth order the negative. Okay. So next question is given here as an example. Check the negative definiteness of the quadratic function. And same question has been P matrix. Okay, P matrix is here multiplied with the minus 1. Okay, then the quadratic function will change minus 7. x1 square minus 4, x1, x2 minus 10, x1, x3 minus 5, x2 square minus 8, x2, x3 minus 9, x3, okay? 9, x3 square, sorry. So, if the function is the positive definition for the x transpose px greater than 0, okay? Now, you can calculate same for the this matrix also, okay? So, you can calculate this. I am leaving this one. Now come to the stationary point. What is the stationary point? Okay. So the stationary point means, for a continuous, this is a very simple line, for a continuous and differentiable function, okay, a stationary point will only got whenever the function fx is continuous and differentiable. If the function is not continuous and differentiable, you were not able to find the stationary point. That is not meaningless, because you can't find the derivative of that function. Okay, so when the function is the differentiable or the continuous fx, then a stationary point may be defined, or a stationary point x star is a point at which the slope of the function vanishes, means the slope of function becomes zero. That is the f dash x becomes zero. F dash x becomes zero means f dash x only becomes zero at the maxima or the minima. Okay, that may be the maxima, that maxima or minima may be the global or maybe the local. You can't comment on that local or the global, but it is damn sure whenever the function f dash x equal to zero, the slope is equal to zero. It means that point is the stationary point, and you got the some time of minima or some time of maxima. Okay, or in many cases you can find out the inflection point also. So in figure 1 you can visualize that f dash x, okay, the slope becomes 0 at the point, at this point, and again from this you can say the maximum, or this is the inflection point. Okay, so at the inflection point, again the slope will become zero for momentarily. Okay, so this is the stationary point, right? Next slide. So then another term I have already told, the relative and global optimum. So the maxima or minima or the optimum value is defined in terms of two terms, first either in the term of local or in the term of global. Okay, so function is said to be said to have a relative or local minimum at the stationary point, that is x equal to x star. Okay, if f x star is less than or equal to f x star plus h, it means for all the sufficiently a small positive and negative value of h. It means what I am saying, a function is said to have a relative local maximum at x equal to x star, you can see from the picture. I am zooming this picture. You can see here for the proper explanation. Okay. See here. For the local minimum or the maximum you can find at the x equal to x star. For the local minimum condition, fx star, okay, should be less than equal to fx star plus h. What it means? It means the function is decreasing as you are going in this direction. Okay. When in the neighborhood of fx, when you are adding some value in the neighborhood, okay, your function is decreasing, your slope is decreasing. When the slope is decreasing, you can say you are going towards the minimum value. And whenever the function becomes zero at x equal to s star, that point is, you can say, local minimum. Simple, right? So for all the surface settling and a small positive and negative value of h, okay, so it can be defined in the other term, a function is said to have a relative or local minimum at x equal to x star if fx star less than equal to fx star plus h for all sufficiently and a small negative value of h, however, in the near vicinity of point x star. Similarly, a point x star is called to be, for the local maximum. Condition should be what? Your function is going to increase when you are going towards the in the neighborhood of positive value. That is, the fx star should be greater when going towards fx star plus h. Okay, so for all that value, right? So a function is said to be a global or absolute minimum. It is a very important line. Now, what is the meaning of global? What is the meaning of global? A function is said to have a global or absolute minimum at x equal to s star when your function is fx star is less than equal to fx. Okay, for all x in domain, means whenever you calculated all the stationary points, okay, all the stationary points you have calculated and you have checked the minimum value, local minimum. Now you have to check from all that local minima set or and on that domain of x, you have to find out fx stars is less than equal to fx. That fx star will gives the, you can say, the local minimum value, right, of that function. Is it clear? So similarly, a function is said to have a global maximum when x equals x square, when fx stars is greater than equal to fx for all that x in domain, right? Now come to this figure. Okay, from this figure you can visualize that the a1 a2 a3, okay, and b1 b2, a1 a2 a3 is the maxima or relative maxima, you can say. However the b1 b2 point is nothing but the minima. Okay, but when you are trying to say this is the local minimum, this is the local maxima, this is the local maxima, okay, however, this is the local maxima. Okay, when you are trying to say for the minimum, this is the local minimum, right? Now from the maxima set, this is the local maxima set, a1 a2 a3 is the local maxima set, or in this set you have to find that x star that is the maximum. So fx star is greater than this fx. So you can say here a2 is the global maximum, however b1 is the global minimum. Okay, from this figure only represents the relative minimum, that is the this figure is the same relative minimum or the same global optimum. Okay, because this is the only one minimum point is there. Okay, there is no competition between the two, three points. Okay, only one point is there, and that point is the global optima, or that is also a minima, right? I think there is no problem in this slide. Okay, so you can see from this picture also, this is the relative minima, this is the global minima, this is the relative maxima. This can be simulated from the MATLAB. Okay, now come to the next function of two variables. Now I am going towards the minimization of function. Okay, so now question is, how will you find the minimum value or the minima of two variables or more than two variables? So from now we are going towards two variables, then we generalize to for the n variables. Okay, the concept will be generalized for the n variables, right? So see here, the concept is very easy. Now we have to identify the maxima minima or the point of inflection. Okay, so it is very easy. What we have to do, we have to find the you can say the first stationary point. Or how you will find the stationary point? You have, for the stationary point, you have to take the gradient function or the gradient of the two variables. Okay, so let's say f is the function of x1, x2, fx1, x2. So first we have to calculate delta f1 by delta x1 equal to 0, and then you have to calculate the delta f by del x2 equal to 0. It will give the stationary point, right? It will give the stationary point, or this stationary point will decide the maxima or minima. So for that you have to calculate it in the vector form, del f1 by del x1 and del f by del x2, or this will give the x1 x2 value, x1 on x2 value, that's the stationary point, right? And from that stationary point we have to calculate the Hessian matrix, okay, or you can to calculate the second derivatives. Okay, the Hessian matrix will define, the Hessian matrix will decide on the basis of the definiteness of the Hessian matrix. On the basis of the definiteness of the Hessian matrix, you can conclude either the that x we have evaluated as a stationary point x1 x2, that is the x1 x star, you can say here that x star is either the representing the local minimum or the local maxima or the inflection point. Okay, so suppose if your h is positive definite, okay, if your h is positive definite, that's the Hessian matrix. Or now you have, you know how the Hessian matrix is calculated for the two variables. Okay, so I'm not going to the details of that. So if h is that positive definite, then the point x equal to x1 x2 is a point of local minima. However, when h is negative definite, then it depends on the local maxima. Same concept we have applied in this class 12th. Okay, whenever the second derivative is the positive, then we have saying the local minima is occurring. However, when the h is Hessian matrix is the negative definite, or the, when the second derivative is the negative, then we have saying the local maxima is occurring. However, if h is neither, neither, then the point x is neither a point of maxima or a minima, right? So for that purpose, a square matrix is positive definite, you know, if all the eigenvalue are positive. Now you know how it is calculated. Okay, so I'm not going to the details of again the positive definite and negative definite function. Okay, now ultimately I am representing for the n variables. It is given here in the term of two variables again. So how you calculate the optimality condition of function, we have already defined. So what we have done, the fx1 comma x2 of two variable function we have taken, we have considered. Now we have perturbed in x1 x2 value. Okay, so it means your x1 star and x2 star is nothing but a stationary point, or the optimum point, you can say. Not I am saying the stationary point, that is not right, correct word. X1 star, x2 star is, let's say, the optimum value. Okay, now from that optimum value, just you have perturbed. Perturbation means you have disturbed the value in the neighborhood. You have added the very small value in that x1 and x2. Okay, so epsilon 1 is added in the x1 star, that is, we have perturbed a very small value in the x1 star, and same in the x2 star as epsilon 2 in the x2 respectively. Okay, now see, when using the Taylor series, what we have to do? For the Taylor series, we have to expand the fx1 star plus epsilon 1 comma x2 star plus epsilon 2 in like this, fx1 star comma x2 star, right? Now we have to take the first derivative with respect to x1 and x2. Okay, so del f by del x1 epsilon 1 at point x1 star and x2 star. Same for the del f by del x2 with respect to, we have differentiating the function with respect to x2, x1 at point x1 equal to x1 star and x2 equal to x2 star into epsilon 2, right? Now we have taken the second derivative, 1 upon 2 factorial, again the same things. Okay, now again the third term is the rest, higher term is written. Okay, now where epsilon 1, epsilon 2, the perturbation is small, I have already told. Therefore, the higher terms of epsilon 1, since epsilon 1, epsilon 2 is a very, very small quantity, now when as you square that value, that squared value representing the as little, you can say, the smaller smaller value, and therefore we can discard or we can neglect that value. Okay, so the value becomes only at the first gradient we have considered, then your function becomes like this. Then we will discuss the saddle point. Okay, so fx1 star plus epsilon 1 comma x2 star plus epsilon 2 minus of fx1 x2 star. Now this is the we have represented in the form of vector del f del x1 del f by del x2 epsilon 1 epsilon 2. That if we multiply the same things, it will become again the equation number, the previous equation, and that is in the that it represents the gradient value. Okay, now the second derivative will represent always a what? It always represent a Hessian matrix. So now see how it is written. So you can see here the 1 upon 2 factorial plus epsilon into epsilon 1 epsilon 2. Okay, and this is the Hessian matrix. This is the Hessian matrix. Okay, and this is the epsilon 1 epsilon 2. This multiplied by the epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2 fact. I am written here wrongly. I think it should be the transpose here, or okay, when you multiply this, then you got the same value, or you can say here you are representing the transpose here. So when epsilon 1 epsilon 2 transpose into this Hessian matrix into epsilon 1 epsilon 2, again you got the previous equation of the second derivative, that is the Hessian matrix. Okay, and the rest of the terms is here. Okay, so now in this way you can represent the equation. Okay, h is nothing but the second derivative at the del 2 fx. Okay, so now your function is positive, your function is either the maxima or the minima, or you can say you attained the local minima or the local maximum for the two variables. How you can calculate it? It means if x1 star plus epsilon 1 comma x2 star plus epsilon 2 minus of this value is greater than 0. Okay, greater than 0. It means the if your Hessian matrix is positive definite. If your Hessian matrix is positive definite, in this case, whenever the greater than, you got the greater than 0, it means you got the Hessian matrix positive definite. Okay, in that case, if the Hessian matrix is positive, it means you got the minima, okay, local minima, or you can got the minimum value of fx at the saddle point or the at the gradient. Whenever you calculate at the gradient, x1 star at x2 star, when x1 star equals to 0, gradient equal to 0, right? In similar way, if your fx1 star plus epsilon 1 comma x2 star plus epsilon 2 minus of fx1 star comma x2 star less than 0, it represent what? It represent Hessian matrix is less than 0, and whenever it is less than 0, your function is negative definite. It means you got the maxima. Okay, so what we have calculated? Conclusion is that what is the necessary and sufficient condition for the local minima or maxima? Necessary condition is for that, first we have to calculate the gradient. Gradient should be, then you calculate gradient equal to 0. That will give the saddle point or the stationary point. Okay, then using that saddle point or the stationary point, for then you calculate the what is the sufficient condition. You have to calculate the Hessian matrix, you have know how to calculate. Then you have to check the Hessian matrix positive definite, negative definite, positive semi definite, positive negative semi definite. Okay, on the basis of that, if the Hessian matrix is greater than 0, then it means you got the minima. And putting that saddle point or putting that inflection point, putting that stationary point in the function, you got the minimum value of that function, right? As vice versa for the maxima. Okay, so this is the problem you have to do. I have given the solution also. So try to do. I am just elaborating the things. The function is given. Okay, the function is given as 20 plus x 2 x 1 minus x 1 square plus 6 x 2. Okay, 6 x 2. Then minus 3 x 2 square divided by 2. Okay, so this is the function. The function is the two variables x 1 and x 2. The x is defined. Basis, first we have to find the gradient vector. The basis on that gradient vector we have to equate it equal to 0. Then x1, x2 you got 1 comma 2. This is the stationary point or the settle point or the inflection point. Based on that stationary point we have calculated the second derivative. The second derivative represents the Hessian matrix. You can see here from the Hessian matrix you check the check the definiteness. Okay, so you can see this is the negative definite. So negative definite means you got the maxima. How you can say that this negative definite? First using Sylvester theorem you can find out, or with the help of the eigenvalue you can again find out. Since the all the eigenvalue are the negative, then you can find you can say that fx is a concave, and when the fx is concave you can find out the global maxima. So there are two theorems by which you can calculate it. Both the theorems I have illustrated to you. On basis based on this you can defend or you can find out the value. Okay, now come to the next topic. Okay, so before going into the next topic of the optimal control constant optimization or the unconstant optimization. Okay, before going to the details of the unconstant optimization, first I want to illustrate this proposition. So whenever, let's say, the quadratic function or the quadratic form x transpose ax is here, let's say, you know, this x transpose ax represent a scalar quantity, right? This scalar quantity alpha x transpose ax is nothing, where x, the dimension of x is n cross 1. However, the what is the dimension of a? Obviously n cross n. And what is the dimension of x? Obviously 1 cross n, right? Based on this, now I'm trying to say what is the differential of this alpha term. Okay, this scalar. So now calculate this. Whenever your function is a matrix, okay, a matrix is your symmetric matrix. Okay, proposition 2, see the proposition 2, alpha is equal to x transpose ax, where a is the symmetric matrix. The differentiation of this matrix is 2 x transpose a into delta x by del z. Okay, so it is very important, you have to remember this one. So here I am given x transpose px. Whenever you calculate the del f by del x, it means 2 px n cross n will got, provided p equal to p transpose, means symmetric matrix should be there. Okay, now come to the derivative of the linear function. Let's say fx is equal to, see very carefully, fx is equal to a1 x1 plus a2 x2 plus a3, see up to the an x. Now how it can be written, it can be written as a1 a2 to up to the an, then multiplied with the transpose of x1 in the column matrix x1 x2 xn. You can write like this. Okay, now when you differentiate this one, you got only the when you differentiate the x fx with respect to x, x1, x2 up to the xn, you only get a matrix, that is the n cross 1 matrix, that is the column matrix, right, or the row matrix. Based on this, now we proceeded towards the unconstant optimization problem. So can we start this optimization problem in the new session? So I am stopping here. And we will start the unconstant optimization problem as a lecture 4, right? So thank you very much.